Namaskar. Very good afternoon and very warm welcome to all my listeners. Listeners, I, Dr. Renu Tomar, is going to talk about part 3 of bilingual education today. Friends, if you remember, just to recall few points which we covered in part 1 and part 2 of the series of lecture on bilingual education, we began with certain questions to ponder. First question which we tried to answer was, what are the benefits of bilingual education? The second question which we tried to answer in our last talk on bilingual education in the series of bilingual education was on the aims of bilingual education. Now, today we will try to talk about problems of bilingual education. Friends, just to recall what bilingual education is, particularly for the listeners who have joined on third part of the series of bilingual education. Bilingual education, if you remember, was to use two languages as a media of instruction for a child or group of children in part or all of the school curriculum. Friends, in my last lecture, I talked about how bilingual education is adopted worldwide, how it is taken in USA, what is the history behind its present structure in America, as well as we also talked about that how bilingual education is treated in European countries. We also talked about what are the aims of bilingual education. We also talked about that if bilingual education is focused upon, then naturally it will lead to certain academic importance for the teachers, particularly it will lead to cognitive development, it will lead to affective development, it will lead to linguistic growth as well as cultural enrichment. These are the several aims to which bilingual education can cater to. We also talked about that it is for the teacher to decide that which goal he or she has to focus, and that can be decided by the teacher based upon the fact that the students are from which level. Secondly, it is also to be decided by the fact that how long bilingual education has been adopted or it is there in the curriculum of the students. Friends, why bilingual education is important presently? I have taken this topic because bilingual education has been given importance in NEP 2020. It has been emphasized that education as a system, may it be at the school level, may it be at the higher education, should cater to the education in the natives language, the education in the Indian languages, the education in the tribal languages also, because it has been emphasized in NEP 2020 that bilingual education should be adopted in school education as well as in higher education. That is why this topic is of very much relevance today. And moreover, we also need to realize that whatever was propagated against the bilingual education, is that factual or there are certain questions regarding those issues or those facts which were communicated against bilingual education? This is something which we are going to talk about when talking about many myths and prejudices grown around bilingual education. When we talk about myths as far as bilingual education is concerned, it is generally taken by the teachers as an exception. It is exception to the default, that is monolingual norm. We need to understand that multilingual is not an exception. It is an added advantage. It is an added advantage to the teachers. It is added advantage to the students as well. Because monolingual norm, as far as nation is concerned or the globe is concerned, cannot go for long. We need to adopt multilingual to understand what kind of culture we have in the nation as well as in the globe. This is the relevance, as well as we would say that this is need of the present era, that we talk about being multilingual, and we not just propagate but also we start practicing it. To practice, we should try to bring that into the curriculum of our school education as well as higher education. Second myth which has grown around bilingual education is that to become bilingual or multilingual, a student needs to have perfect of native like command or both all of their languages. Friends, this is something which we need to rule out, because if students will realize that language is nothing but a carrier for providing some commands, information, instruction or knowledge. So, language in itself need not be perfect, but it need to play the perfect role as far as communicating is concerned. So, language has to be understood not from the point of view of linguistic perfection. It has to be understood from the point of view of best communicator. It should be utilized by the learner as well as teacher in such a manner that it communicates to the maximum. It communicates the information, knowledge to the maximum. So, this is something which we need. This myth which we need to take care of, that the bilingual education doesn't mean that the student has to become perfect or native like. The third myth which is there as far as bilingualism is concerned is that if bilingualism is introduced to the children during their childhood, it may be detrimental to both linguistic and cognitive development and consequently lead to poorer results at school. Friends, this is an excuse often given by the people who doesn't stand for bilingualism. They often state that because of the pressure of another language being introduced to the children will not be able to perform well. Friends, this is also a myth which need to be ruled out, but this because this is a proven fact by various researches that if the student is good at the native language, if that native language is being understood well, then the student will be able to understand the foreign language as well as the second or the third language which is being introduced to him. Because the language which is known to the child, which he or she has learnt, always form basis of the third language or the fourth language which is being taught to the student. So, friends, this is a myth which we need to deal with as to make our teachers understand that bilingualism is not detrimental to either linguistic development or to cognitive development. In fact, it is an important asset. It plays the part of the tool to propagate as well as help the learner to understand the second language or the third language. Another myth which the students or the teachers usually come across whenever they think of going for bilingualism is that if we expose a child to more than one tongue, that may cause language impairment or deficit. Because this is often stated by the educationists who are against bilingualism, that whenever the language which is being taught to the student, that language come along with it with certain grammatical understanding, with certain linguistic understanding, and that understanding will overlap in case we are exposing the child to two languages or the third languages. Friends, this is not so. In fact, one language generally forms a base for the second language learning or the third language learning or the fourth language learning. Because usually it is seen when the child or the students or the learners who are good at the second language or the third language or the foreign language, they have been interacting in their native language, they have learned their native language well, and that has usually formed the base for the other languages. Because worldwide we would see that certain linguistic or certain grammatical similarity is there in almost all the languages. And in fact, we cannot teach any language in vacuum. To teach any language, we need to have certain base, and that base will be provided by the language which the child already knows. Another myth which surrounds to as far as this language learning is concerned or the bilingualism is concerned is that the third language or the fourth language or the fifth language which is being introduced will cause unnecessary pressure and efforts. Friends, language learning is similar to the fact that we learn one skill. In fact, the language of two kinds, may it be, like, to take an example, if a child knows Bangla, would we say that the child will face problem for learning Hindi? Definitely not. Will it cause unnecessary pressure on the child? Definitely not. Because the child who is well versed with Bangla will find certain base to learn Hindi. Similarly, if the child knows English, then naturally the child will be more comfortable with French. So, there are certain languages which are interlinked. So, we have to understand that language learning does not cause any unnecessary pressure or efforts. Another myth which is linked to bilingualism is that children who are engaged in learning languages, they don't have enough time to learn both the language, and the result is that they acquire both the language half-heartedly or not completely. Now, friends, let us try to understand this myth. This myth says that if the child is being taught two or three languages, that will result in him not acquiring majority of any of the languages. Friends, again, this is a myth. Why is it a myth? Because every language, when the child is using it, practicing it, it becomes a skill. And each skill will be different from another. Language may be a skill, but English language or Hindi language or the native language, they are correlated skill, but not the same one. In fact, any skill, just like a language speaking is a skill, is acquired only and only after practicing it. So, if the child practices more and for a long term, for a long duration, then naturally the child will become well versed in not one language but two or three languages. And in fact, it is also known that a child, particularly till the age of 8 or 9, does have that capability or ability as far as cognitive development is concerned. The child can learn languages easily. It has been seen, it has been proven by various researches. So, it is very much factual and very much important that we introduce different languages at the school level itself, so that child acquire that language at the school level and takes it on at the higher education. Particularly if we talk from the perspective of policy, friends, we need to realize that as far as the policy is concerned, they have to be very much vibrant. They have to be open to the fact that a child who is coming from an area where he is more comfortable in his own native language or the any other Indian language, he or she has equal right to the higher education as the child who is well versed in English. And because each student has to be treated as equal, his knowledge has to be taken into consideration. So, it becomes responsibility of the policy framers. It becomes responsibility of the teaching community that we introduced languages parallelly. The child should be having access to the information and knowledge even in Indian languages, even in native languages. That will not just help the child to gather the more information and become more knowledgeable and be successful in the life, but that will also help for us to preserve our culture. Because friends, we should not be forgetting that as far as language is concerned, that is one of a part and parcel of culture. Through language, we transmit culture. So, we cannot overlook the languages of India. We cannot even overlook the languages which are becoming day by day which are becoming less spoken, particularly the tribal languages. We have to take care of even those languages. They should not become extinct. They are not dinosaurs that after century we have to search for, okay, there existed some tribal language which was not catered by certain generation and the result was that it become extinct. This should not be happening. We should be catering to the fact that every language is a tool to the culture. It has correlation with the culture, so it has to be preserved. And to preserve it, we don't have to preserve it in the books. We have to preserve it in the minds of the students. How will we preserve it in the minds of a student? By using it more and more. Not just using by getting the degrees, master's degrees or doctorates or MPhil in the tribal language, but also helping the students to do degrees even in history or geography also in their native language or the language which they are well versed. So friends, from here on, after we have covered the myths which are related to the bilingual education, now let us try to understand what are the characteristics of good bilingual education program. Because if the schools have to introduce it, how they should be doing it. This is something which all of us need to understand, that what are the characteristics of good bilingual education program. Before understanding it, first of all, we have to understand that the curriculum has to be framed in such a manner. Because whenever we have certain curriculum framed, that is framed for acquiring of certain knowledge or skills, which the child will be learning in the school and using it in the life ahead. Because of the fact that curriculum is basically taught with this purpose in mind, with certain educational objectives in mind, accordingly bilingual education program has to be initiated and accordingly bilingual education has to be adopted. That means we will have to design school curriculum. The school curriculum will have to be designed in such a manner that the students become linguistically, culturally and developmentally become more understanding as far as that bilingualism is more appropriate for those students, and they should be having the characteristics which we are going to discuss in few seconds and as well as in the second fourth part of the series of lecture on bilingual education when we will be talking about characteristics. Friends, to begin with, as far as the characteristics of the students who should be using bilingual education or the curriculum which should be framed for bilingual education is that the students will have to perform as far as expectation is concerned, because if the bilingualism is introduced, that means students will have to work as far as their academic goals is concerned, their program goals are concerned, their curriculum goals are concerned. They will have to work harder because there will be higher expectations for those students. It will be expected that the students who are studying bilingual, they should be able to perform well even in those languages. Friends, in my previous lecture, I talked about whenever bilingualism is talked about, researchers have proven that bilingualism is the best tool for educating children of two kinds. One, who are higher than the average students, because they are the students who can be provided with aims or objectives which are of higher level, because they have got more knowledge, or we would say they have got more IQ or understanding of the languages. Secondly, bilingualism also suits the students who are at the lower level. For that, we cited the example of America, because bilingualism or the bilingual education in America was propagated for the students who were from the poor socioeconomic background. That was propagated for the students or promoted or accepted for the students who were to be brought to the level of English speaking or English using students. So, and that really worked as a very good tool to bring those students up to the level of English speaking or English knowing students, because they were termed as or seen as by educationists in America as average or above average students. And the students who were speaking Spanish, German or other languages, they were given to use those languages as well as English was introduced, so that they come in the, as far as their school studies is concerned, school education is concerned, steadily they come to the level of English using students. So, two examples which we cited in our previous lecture, that has to be kept in mind. One, in European countries, bilingual education is seen for as something which is for the above average students, and it is seen as a kind of an advantage for all the students or as well as learner. And in USA, bilingual education is seen as a tool to bring to the average level of education, which begins in English only, which is given in English only. So, friends, from here on, let us come down to the second characteristic that which the student has to cater to, that a curriculum as far as bilingualism is concerned, that will be comparable to the material which is covered in the English only classroom. That means the curriculum will not be brought down for the bilingual students. The curriculum will be at par. So, they have to understand that the bilingualism may be a tool to come down, to come up to the level of English speaking student, but the curriculum may be taught in the medium which is native to the child, but the curriculum will be of equal level. It will not be brought down. Friends, another characteristic which we need to understand is for the students to gather or to introduce bilingualism in the school languages, school education, is that instructions have to be through the native language for the subject matter. This is one aspect, and this example goes for the American students or the USA students, because they were the students who were given instructions in their native languages, but the curriculum was at par with the English speaking students, and English was added in their curriculum as an additional language. Another important characteristics which we need to understand when we talk about bilingualism is that English language development is to be seen as a component. Here we can replace this English language development with Spanish or French or Russian or Mandarin also. So, this is a component which is additional to the language in which all the subjects are being taught. The subjects may be taught in the native language, or for the students who want to cater to the higher language learning, for them the first language may be English and the second language may be Russian or Mandarin or French or Spanish. So, that language development component also needs to be developed. Friends, on this note, I, Dr. Renu Tomar, take the leave and shall be joining you soon in few minutes to talk about other characteristics which bilingualism or bilingual education should cater to. Namaskar. Good afternoon. Have a good day.